12 again. So the first thing I'll do is to write down the total action for the in gauge theory that we had found. Okay, and I'll first consider the case of pure gauge theory, which means only gauge fields and no formulas or scalars. Okay, and then we'll see how to incorporate formulas and scalars. The total action. So the action was given as follows with an integral d4x. So first we have the gauge kinetic term, and I'll write down now in the explicit expansion. So we are using summation convention, so repeated indices are automatically sum. So this was the gauge invariant part of the action. Then we have a gauge fixing term, which is minus 1 over 2 alpha. Then you have the ghost kinetic term. And then you have the ghost interaction term. For the gauge indices, it doesn't matter whether I write the index up or down. Okay, we are not distinguishing between upper index and lower index. So this is the total action with which you have to work. But when you calculate, for example, S matrix element or the expectation value of operators, you only look for operators which are made of the AMUs, and in that also you restrict to gauge invariant operators. Okay, because this is inherited from an original gauge invariant theory, and in order to go from the original formulation to this formulation in terms of ghosts and gauge fixing terms, we have seen that this equivalence between these two work only for gauge invariant operators. Okay, otherwise, it's not the same as original theory.
If someone has given me this action, you're mentioning that it comes from some Bayes theory, one would have likely taken this BC in the external lines as well.
Yes, sir, exactly.
But does the spin statistics theorem ensure that their scattering cross section will always be zero?
No. No, not necessarily. If you take the BC in the external lines, you'll get all kinds of nonsensical results which will violate various axioms of quantum field theories, including, for example, it will not give a unitary amplitude.
Yeah.
So, but if we want to know why BC cannot appear in the external state from this formalism, one has to use what I mentioned yesterday, that BRST invariance. So once you understand BRST symmetry of this, right, then the BRST symmetry itself gives a procedure for determining which external states are allowed and which are not allowed. Yeah, so that's the way you can rule out BC in the external state. But at this level, if I just give you this action, then you will in principle calculate everything. Are there other questions?
Yes.
Well, I have not even introduced QB. We have to wait till. So, no, we will see what the correspondence is, right? How you have to use BRST symmetry, right? and then we'll see how it comes about here. So right now we are just working with this axon, and we have to keep in mind that this axon is derived from the original gauge invariant theory, and so the only things which are sensibly calculated using this axon are expectation knowledge of gauge invariant operators. Okay. So now what we are going to do is to use this axon to derive the Feynman rules of this theory. Okay. So Feynman rules in this case will involve first of all finding the propagators. So there are two sets of fields. One is the gauge field. We have to find the propagator for the gauge field. And then there is a ghost DC system. So you have to find the propagator for the ghost. And then we will try to understand the interactions. So we start from the gauge field kinetic term. So this comes from two sources. One is that you pick these terms. Kinetic term is quadratic in A. So you multiply this with this. That gives you a term quadratic in A. And then this also has a term quadratic in A. So these are the two sources of kinetic terms. So you have to combine them. Now to combine this with this, we can see that because the second one is already anti-symmetrized in mu nu, we can just drop the anti-symmetrization in the first term and multiply the result by 2. Is that clear? We are taking the sum product of this and this. This is already anti-symmetrized in mu nu. So you can just forget about this minus sign and replace the minus 1 fold by minus half. So this gives you integral d fold x minus half L mu nu A L mu nu plus half L. Is this okay? I multiply this with this and this with this. The second term has a minus sign, so that made it plus half. And then you have something from here, minus 1 over 2 alpha mu So I'll now rewrite this in a different way. So I'll integrate by parts to put all the derivatives on the second one. The first one will be minus half a nu box plus half. Second one. In fact, second and third, you consider they are the same. So you have basically 1 minus 1 over alpha. And here you have a nu.
It is 1 plus alpha?
1 plus?
Yeah, because division by parts of that.
In front there will be plus.
Yeah. In front of this.
Yeah.
The whole thing.
It's one plus.
Yeah. No, not 1 plus. Because these are the minus sign, right?
Yeah.
I integrated the parts and become plus.
Yeah.
So this minus times minus
Yeah.
This is okay? So now to calculate the propagator, I have to write in a momentum space. So in the momentum space, this has a form d4k over 2 pi to d4 out outside. Now let me write this as follows. case, or can I write M? M. Is given by what's delta MB. This one?
No, in the next line, last line. Del mu, del mu.
1 minus 1 by alpha.
Yes. Oh. Yes. I have interchanged mu and nu in one of the terms, because this one a mu, a nu, right? Because del mu is totally symmetric in mu nu, right? It doesn't matter for that to put the mu on this side or that side. Okay, the general structure is that it's mu and nu are carried by a, okay, and the two derivatives are carried by mu, also carry mu and nu. And that's the structure of the second term. The first term is there's a box and the indices of a get contracted. Is this okay, or should I do it? Just exchange. See, here, when I put it on the other side, I already got a nu, del nu, a nu, right? Here, when you put it on the other side, I had a nu first and nu here.
Okay.
But nu and nu are, of course, completely symmetric, right? So I just exchange nu and nu. So that's nu and nu. Okay. So here, you have minus a square. Plus
1 minus 1 over alpha.
Is this okay? I replace box by minus k square. Okay, because every derivative is I k mu, and this one I replace by I k mu times I k mu, so that's minus k mu, that made this plus. Okay? So from this we can read out the gauge field propagator. So first of all, let's say how will you know the gauge field propagator. So here is our index mu a, mu b. So the notation for this is that this is P1, this is P2. This is the expectation value of A nu, P1, A nu, K2. Okay, because K1 always enters the vortex, right? That's the convention you have been choosing. So K1 should be going in this direction, K2 should be going in this direction. If we recall the expression for that, by following the same procedure we had done for general A maybe, right? We had an MKL, if you remember, right? Then we wrote down the propagator in terms of inverse. So this should be given by M inverse, MK1 inverse. In this case, it doesn't matter whether it's K1 or K2, but in general it's MK2 inverse, MK1 inverse, let me know. times just compare this form that I have here, you see, with the general form that I wrote down, okay, even phi k and phi l, if you remember the general bosonic fields. Once the kinetic term has this form, the propagator is given by this. Okay, in this case, it doesn't matter very much where you put the indices AB or mu nu because everything is symmetric. Okay, but it's good to keep in mind in general, right? In case where you don't get a symmetric matrix, where the indices go. Okay, and this is the way the indices are supposed to go if you look in the old formula. Pardon?
Yeah,
two by 24. And as we had discussed earlier, it's for most use, it's just best to just drop these factors and restore it at the end in terms of overall momentum conserving delta function. Right? So you drop these functions from the vortices as well as from the propagators. Okay, so I've written it here, but from now on I'll try to drop these factors from the expression for the propagator and vortices. Okay, but we have to calculate this. Mk inverse, okay, where Mk is given by this. So, one way to calculate this, there are different ways to calculate this. You can go to a specific frame and try to directly invert the matrix. Okay. But the one way to calculate this is to write down the most general form that is possible for Mk, okay, consistent with Lorentz symmetries. And, of course, in the AB space, you know that it has to be proportional to delta AB, right? Because identity in the gauge space, so its inverse is also identity. So we use the ansatz that Mk inverse in A U is given by delta AB, and then we say A of K beta mu nu plus g of k theta k mu k. Okay, this is the most general Lorentz invariant, Lorentz covariant form that you can write down. And now the idea is that we will determine these coefficients A and B by requiring that M inverse times M becomes identity. This clear? So let's calculate Mk inverse A mu B mu, and then say Mk, you want to calculate B mu 0, say. So you expect this to be delta AC. And then delta mu rho. But when you put these expressions explicitly, we get delta AB times A delta mu nu plus B K mu K nu times what you have here. Minus k square eta mu eta mu nu, so you need
delta.
Yes, delta. Let's put the delta also. Delta BC. We have minus k square eta mu rho plus 1 minus 1 over alpha
maximum in P of.
Okay, so all we have to do now is to multiply it and see what we get. So we get a delta AC, which of course engages with this, let me put this here. For gauge index, as I have been saying, it doesn't matter whether the index is up or down. So delta AC, so first you get minus A times K square times eta nu rho. Sorry, delta nu rho. Then you have this times this minus e a square d nu k rho. And then you have a times this plus A times 1 minus 1 over alpha, again k nu k rho. And then finally we have this times this, that's plus b times 1 minus 1 over alpha. Now k mu with k mu gives you k square, so k square. And then again, is this okay? So now we have to equate these to one because that's what we want, and then the rest of the coefficients to zero. So this gives you minus a k square equal to one. So a is minus 1 over k square, and then the other equation tells us, you see, bk square, okay, let's put everything on the other side. So 1 minus 1 plus 1 over alpha b equal to a times 1 minus 1 over alpha. So b 1 over k square times alpha minus 1 times a. So with this we can now write the propagator mk inverse a nu b mu. So mk inverse a nu b mu is delta a b. Minus 1 over k square. So I have taken the b on the other side, keeping the a on.
No, I am putting a equals to minus 1 on this. I mean, if you put a equals to minus 1 on this, then there
will be. Yeah, so what I am going to do is I will take minus 1 over k square outside, and then eta nu rho, nu mu, minus one minus alpha in it, like this. So this is minus, so this I can write minus 1 over a square times 1 minus alpha times c. So a, once you have taken the a out, a part is out, that is the minus 1 over k square. We have eta nu mu, that is the coefficient of the eta nu mu part, okay, that a you have taken out. And then from b, again I have taken a out, so it's minus 1 over k square times 1 minus alpha times k nu. So that is our gauge field property. And you can see that it depends on the choice of alpha. So let me just say here that there are two special choices of alpha which are often used. So alpha equal to 1, this is called Feynman gauge. If you set alpha equal to 1, then this term goes away. And the propagator becomes I minus I k square inverse times eta. Okay, minus I, this I comes from this I over here.
That should be a plus sign. Eta meaning plus.
Eta mean which should be plus sign? No, see the point is there is an A here, right?
Yeah.
So I have taken the A outside. That is minus 1 over k square, right? So now you have, there's a minus 1 over k square plus 1 minus 1.
Why is there an I?
Why? Oh, the I is this I, which is somewhat hidden there, which you don't. I mean, the propagator has I times M inverse, right? So this I is what is appearing there. The other questions?
Delta.
Delta, thank you. Okay. So the other choice which is often used is alpha equal to 0, this is for lambda gauge. In this case, it's a little more complicated. The propagator is I minus k square inverse delta u and then eta mu nu minus k square inverse kb.
So this dependence on alpha, that is the gauge choice, is coming because nu nu is not gauge unit.
Exactly. Right? I mean, you can easily check that when you try to calculate the f mu nu f rho sigma using this propagator. Yes, that's the next exercise I'll give. Okay, so exercise. Calculate f mu nu k1 okay, here the tilde just means Fourier transform, okay, not duality or dual or anything, just Fourier transform. If you calculate this using the mu nu two point function that we gave, that this first of all is alpha independent. And that it agrees with earlier result for QVD. Okay, this is was part of the homework problem, right? You remember in QVD we had another way of evaluating this, which is to basically remove one of the modes, right, and then carry out path integral over the three modes, okay, in which case the propagator is invertible. But this will have the same value. Right? Because after all, you are calculating the same quantity. Right? We did it one way here. We are doing it in another way here. The fact that it's non-abelian gate symmetry, it plays no role as far as the kinetic term is concerned. Right? Because the kinetic term is still F mu nu. Is this okay? So I'm going to come back to this in a few minutes later. Yes.
Initially we will depend 1 by 2, 1 over 2 by alpha, that it is still dependent.
Yes, so you can think of this as alpha goes to zero limit. If you want to also see what the alpha going to zero limit does to the expression that I had, alpha entered because I wrote this, it will be I over 2 alpha BABA, right? That's where it came from. And that gave this to the I over 2 alpha HH after you do the BA integral. Right? So that is a delta function. So they are taking alpha goes to zero limit, right? Means that it becomes a Gaussian which is more and more short lived around H A equal to zero, right? Because it is I wrote it to be I over two alpha, but there is also an epsilon. Right? So it's really minus I times one plus I epsilon over two alpha. Then it to the minus epsilon over two alpha, which is a damping factor. Right? That becomes more and more short lived in the alpha goes to zero limit. So it becomes a delta function. So alpha goes to zero limit is equivalent to having the original delta function form, right? In which you are actually just inserted delta of H A minus A. If you had inserted just delta of H A, right? Setting A equal to zero, that's equivalent to taking the alpha goes to zero limit of this. Okay, but this result, of course, will be valid for general alpha, right? All physical quantities should be independent of alpha. So the idea is that you can use this freedom to vary alpha. So for some purpose, it may be useful to use one value of alpha. Right? For some other purpose, it may be useful to use another value of alpha. But since you know that for physical quantities, the value of alpha makes no difference, you can use different alphas to prove different properties of the theory. What you have to remember is that when you are calculating an amplitude by summing over Feynman graphs, you must use the same alpha for all Feynman graphs. Right? Because it's only the sum over Feynman graph that has the property that it's independent of a choice of gauge. Okay? So you must not change your choice of gauge, okay, while calculating Feynman diagrams. Other questions? So next we consider the Ghost property. Here, our Ghost kinetic term. We start with the Ghost kinetic term, it will eventually lead to Ghost propagator. So this is integral d4x, a of x box c of x, so which is integral d4x. So the Ghost propagator will use a dotted line. But the Ghost propagator has different ends, or the host propagators represent different ends. Right? One end is B, the other one is C. Okay? That's like psi and psi bar that we had for formulas. Okay? So you have to specify somehow that which end is B, which end is C. Okay? And we'll use the convention, this is again purely a matter of convention, that the B end is, we'll put an arrow, okay? And the arrow comes out of the B end and goes towards the C end. Okay, that will be the convention we'll be using. So we'll draw an arrow here. So this end will be B. Well, let me put the C on this side. So this end will be B. This end will be C tilde. So this carries the index A. This carries the index B. We can say this is K1. This is K2. And the propagator will be I times minus 1 over K square times delta. So one thing you can notice is that there is no half here. Right? Unlike in the scalar fields or the gauge fields where you had a half, here there is no half. Okay? And this is because the two ends are different. Okay, this is exactly like psi bar psi that we had. Okay? In the case of psi bar psi, okay, we didn't have a half in front of the axon. Nevertheless, the propagator had this structure, there was no extra half in the propagator. Okay? And that has to do with the fact that when you take derivatives with respect to this delta delta j, when the two ends are the same, you get extra factor of 2. Okay? That half compensates basically for that extra factor of 2. That's not the idea. So this represents this expectation value. C tilde A, C tilde B. This is C tilde B of K2. Again, if we exchange this, you give a minus sign. Okay? So then you may wonder which one is correct. Right? So that this is the correct one, or the other way is the correct one, that those two differ by a sign. Okay? And you can fix the sign by following exactly the same procedure we use for formulas. Okay? There, the action had psi bar psi. If you remember, so B is playing the role of psi bar, C is playing the role of psi. Okay, psi bar psi. Okay? But the propagator represents the psi bar. Two-point function, right? Psi came first, psi bar came second. That's the analog, that the C comes first, B comes second. Okay, we can show that with this definition of the propagator, there is an extra minus sign over there. Okay? So the calculation is exactly identical. You insert the corresponding currents, okay, that couple to B and C, just like we inserted the J's. Okay? Then carry out the path integral, okay? Evaluate this two-point function, and you will find that this is the result. The result for this is given by this times, of course, the 2 pi to the 4 delta k on plus k2, which you have not did.
This k square should be either
k1
or
k2. Yes, this should be k on or k2. In this case, it doesn't matter. Other questions? Okay. So this is important because if we have a Feynman diagram with lots of ghost vortices, for example, right? And you have those vortices and you have to connect them by propagators, okay. Which sign that Feynman diagram carries will again be determined by that same contraction rules, right? You contract the C's and B's in this case instead of psi and psi bars. Okay. And how many times it intersects, those lines will determine whether the amplitude has positive sign or negative sign.
Where is the K2 contribution going? I mean,
there is a hidden factor which I didn't write down, right? 2 pi to the 4 delta 4 K1 plus K2. Okay? This factor I just keep dropping. Okay, so this basically sets k1 equal to minus a. Are there any questions? Okay, so now then we'll turn to the interaction vortices. Okay, because those are the second ingredient of calculating a final.
So in lambda gauge, that will be k1 then.
In lambda gauge?
I mean, in the propagator of.
See, the host.
No, not here. Yeah.
Yes, these will be all. Here I just wrote k because I didn't specify k1 or k2. See, whenever we drop that delta function, right? Then I label this in this way, that we have a k momentum flowing in some direction, and then you have some a nu and b mu, right? We had something like a nu b mu. Okay, this is the way I write the propagator. Okay, because I don't, now I don't write separately k1 or k2, right? I just have to write k, then k1 will be either k or minus k, depends on which end is representing k1. Okay, so this is the standard notation for the propagator that one uses if we drop that 2 pi to the 4 delta function term. Then it's just written this way. Is this point clear? Okay, so whether it's k1 or k2, okay, this k will determine. Yeah, if you follow the derivation, right, it's clear that the Gauss propagator doesn't depend on alpha, right? Because the Gauss propagator was a determinant, right, which didn't depend on B. See, because B was just a constant added to HA, right? It was delta of HA minus BA. So the determinant didn't depend on B, right? And alpha interact through B integrals. Right? That's the reason the Gauss propagator doesn't depend on alpha. Even the Gauss interactions also do not depend on alpha. Okay? So the alpha dependence must cancel among themselves. With the gauge fields, right? The hosts are not going to help you in cancelling the alpha dependence. Right? But if you change H itself, right? Suppose from the del mu mu equal to 0 type gauge, right? You go to some other gauge, say you set A0 equal to 0. Okay? Then the host part will change. Yeah. Okay, but the alpha dependence cancels by itself. Is this clear?
So if we had initially taken all the Bs to be 0.
All the?
Bs to be 0. So the more important part is to fix the Hs. I mean what functions you are taking, right?
Yes.
So you can set it to any value. That will just tell you what kind of curve, I mean the value of it. So if you set the Bs equal to 0 in the first place, then you wouldn't have been able to do this.
Yeah. Well, the point is Bs were introduced so that I keep one constant freedom and I average over it. Right? See, if you set the Bs to be 0 from the beginning, then you have a delta function. Right?
Yes.
For certain choice of Hs, you can explicitly solve. For example, A0 equal to 0 gauge. Suppose you want to choose A0 equal to 0 gauge, right? Then that means from all your expressions, you just drop A0.
Yes.
Okay? Which you could do easily. But suppose you want to choose del mu mu equal to 0. Right? Then it's not easy to write down explicit solutions of that.
Yes.
Okay? In terms of three variables. You can in principle do it, but it's just cumbersome. Okay. So to avoid those situations, you give this B freedom.
Yes.
Okay, so that in gauges of the form where it's not easy to eliminate, okay, you can use that B, okay, averaging over B, to write it as a term in the action. Okay. Then you don't worry about eliminating any variable, you integrate over all variables.
Yes.
Okay. But the fact that you have that extra term in the action is equivalent to what you are doing already. Okay, so the B is just a trick that we use, okay, so that eventually you can average. Is this okay? Any other questions? Okay, so now interactions. first A, A, A.
Fifthly.
So these come from each term in this F mu nu F mu nu, right? There's a linear term and then there's a quadratic piece. Okay? So you take the product of the linear part and the quadratic part, that gives you a triple A coupling. Okay? That's the origin of this triple A coupling. Now there's a minus one for one quarter sitting outside. Number. There is a factor of 2, which comes from the fact that it's like A plus B multiplying A plus B. Okay? So the AB cross term comes twice. Okay? First term of the first one times second term of the last one and vice versa. Okay? So that gives a factor of 2, okay, which we'll not worry about. There is another factor of 2 that you can get. Okay? If you drop the anti-symmetrization in del mu a nu minus del mu a mu, you can just pick del mu a nu term, because the term that you are multiplying it with is already anti-symmetric in mu and nu. You can check that, right? Because it's, let me write this, then it will become clear. Del mu a nu a, so let me write times 2, so del mu a nu times g F A B C A D E A D mu A E mu. Okay, this is the kind of term you are going to get. But this one you can see, this is totally anti-symmetric in under A D E X, right? F A D E. So in particular, if you exchange D and E, that's equivalent to exchanging mu and nu. If you exchange D and E and at the same time mu and nu, it has exactly the same structure. Is this clear? So what I'm trying to say is that it's this expression is anti-symmetric in under mu nu exchange. Okay? Because if you exchange mu and nu, you can bring it into the original form, but also extending, re-leveling D and E. But when you re-level D and E, this picks up a minus sign. So because of this, the other term, minus del nu A mu that we had, okay, that we are dropping, and we are multiplying by this another factor. Okay, so this is the structure of the term. And then you have integral before x. Now we'll write in the momentum space. So minus g times f a d e integral d 4 t 1 times A tilde P mu 1 A tilde mu 2 A tilde E, let us go A 3 beta derivatives of IQ1 You see what I have done here, that I wrote this as rho, A rho, and contracted by eta nu rho. Okay, that's why this here the three indices are are defined indices. And then I replace this del del x mu, which is acting on the first one, okay, by ik1. That's it.
What should be a factor of I in the vertex?
Yes. So, I'm just writing the interaction term. So, when you write the vertex, there will be an overall factor of I, right? Because that comes from e to the is. Is this okay? So, now the idea is that then you can, of course, work with this vertex. But this quantity, see this object over here, okay, all of these are A fields. Okay. So there should be a symmetry under ADE exchange, arbitrary exchange of arbitrary permutations of ADE simultaneously with nu, mu rho and k1, k2, k3. Okay. You don't have to, at this level, it doesn't matter whether you symmetrize or not. So you actually write down the Feynman diagrams, right? You either have to symmetrize the vertex, right? Or you have to keep track of, you have to think of this as different vertices, right? In one of them, k1 comes from something, eta nu rho comes from something, and so on, right? There are different kinds of vertices. So what we can do is that we replace this by 1/6 times this with all possible symmetrization. 1/6 because permutation of three objects, permutation of three things, right? So there are 6 factorial, not just cyclic permutation, so sorry, 3 factorial, that's 6, right? That's why it's 1/6 times a sum of 6 terms. Is that okay?
Worry about it if
they're
scalars, right?
I
mean, if they're scalars,
yes.
Then if 5 and 5 to 5 3, then it will.
Well, then I mean, if they're scalars, you can either, if you keep track of which one is 5 1, which one is 5 2, which one is 5 3, then they're different anyway. You don't have to worry about this.
Yeah.
But if you want to write it as 5i, 5j, 5k,
yes,
times some vijk, okay, then that vijk, it's easier to symmetrize, right? It's a question of whether you are calculating the drawing or Feynman diagrams in terms of each individual field, or whether you are drawing it in terms of the with an index, right? If you are drawing it with an index, right, if you, instead of thinking of three scalar fields, phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, if you just think of this as phi I, right, as a general, which I, where I can take any value, right, 1, 2 or 3, then it's best to symmetrize it, right? Then the Feynman diagrams can be drawn directly without worrying about which field is what.
Okay.
So each scalar propagator will now represent either 1 or 2 or 3. You are summing over all of this. Is this okay?
But here should be theta.
Pardon?
For this case, it is already symmetric and then nu and rho. So
but see, the point is, if you exchange nu and rho, okay, you also have to exchange k1 and k3. See, you have to exchange all the quantum numbers, right? In fact, you also have to exchange a and e. A and E exchange is okay because this is has already anti-symmetrized. Okay? So A and E exchange you can just use a minus sign. But if we exchange nu rho, it is true that this is anti-symmetric in nu rho. Okay? But this is not symmetric under K1 K3 exchange. Is this clear? Okay, that's the reason why you have to actually add 6 terms. Okay, not just 3 terms. So this one will replace, let's see what we replace it by. The body, if we had written it inside, okay, what you should strictly do is that I should write this FAD as multiplying this, okay, then symmetrize, write all 6 terms, okay, where all these indices are permuted, right? The one will say it's 1, 2, 3, arbitrary permutation of 1, 2, 3, right? That will mean that you have to exchange these, you have to exchange these, as well as you have to exchange these. But all I'm saying is that exchanging these just costs the sign. We have to just keep track of the sign. Okay, otherwise you will not have to worry. So this I can keep as FAD as it is. I am not trying to take it inside. Okay, but we have to keep in mind that it sometimes you may pick a sign, because if you are exchanging two, right, then this changes sign. Okay, and we'll take that into account. So this I suggest to replace by this. The first term will be eta and euro. Okay, let me write it in slightly. So it's I k1 mu eta and euro. Okay, plus permutations is what you have to add. So you have to basically pick all six all five permutations of these and add those five terms. Okay. So it's easiest to follow the following sequence, but you can choose any other sequence that you like. That if we use cyclic permutations first, right? 1, 2, 3, there are three cyclic permutations. 2, 3, 1 and 3, 1, 2. Okay. Under cyclic permutations, F doesn't change sign. Okay, F A D is the same as F E A D, F D E A. Okay. So for those, we add with this plus sign. Then we exchange one, right? That gives a minus sign. And then again, sum over all cyclic permutations of that configuration. Okay, so that's the way we are going to do this sum. Okay, so first let's add the cyclic permutations. So I shift one on this set. So K1 will go to K2, right? K2. Mu goes to what? It was K1 mu, right? Mu goes to low. So K2 low. Right? Then we have a eta nu low. So nu eta nu low. So here so nu goes to mu and rho goes to nu, right? So eta mu nu. This is clear? Then we take plus I k3. Now again see rho goes to what under cyclic permutation?
New.
Rho goes to new. So K3 new. Well, once this is new, you know that this has to be new. Right? Because 3 in this three. Yeah. So next you have to subtract. Right? Next ones are all with minus tens. So first let's do one thing. We keep say one fixed and exchange 2 and 3. So K1 remains at K1, okay. Mu becomes rho. Okay. So minus I K1 rho, and this has to be for mu. Now again, let's cyclically permute these three in this, right? So minus I K2. So rho is going to nu, so k to nu, eta mu rho, minus I k 3. So now mu is going to mu, so k 3 mu. Okay, so this is the vortex. Okay, we can write this in a somewhat more symmetric fashion. For example, eta nu rho coefficient has I q r nu minus k 3 nu. Right? So similarly, each eta coefficient you can collect. Okay, maybe we'll do that when we write the vortex. So now, let's write the vortex. So here is a vortex. So you have a nu. This is carrying A mu, K1 is entering. This is D mu, K2 is entering. D mu, K2 is entering. And this one, this is E rho. So there's a minus, now you multiply by I, okay, that minus I just take all the I factors outside, so that, you know, those cancel, so I get 1/6 G F A D E. Then here I's have gone, so K1 mu minus K3 mu eta mu rho. Okay, that takes care of these terms. Then eta mu nu, okay, I K2 rho minus K1 rho eta mu nu plus K2 rho. We're left with eta mu rho, so that's K3 mu minus K2 mu. Okay, so this is the triple gauge vortex. Is this clear? So next we have the port A. So A, 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 A. So this comes from, let's see, is a minus 1/4. Then you have F A B C F A B E. So okay, this is the structure. If you take the quadratic term, which is coming from the quadratic term in F, multiplied by quadratic term in F, okay, now the minus 1/4 remains as it is. Okay, and this is what you get. Okay, this is integral. Okay. So now you do whatever is you are supposed to do, so minus g square by 4 integral d4 k1 by 2 pi to the 4 up to d4 k4 by 2 pi to the 4 delta 4 So we have eta mu rho, eta mu sigma, if ABC, if ADE. Okay. So again, you have to symmetrize, right? To have an efficient boundary motion theory, you have to symmetrize. Okay. So the most naive thing that you can do is then multiply by 1 over 24 times all boundary motion. So we take this, we can replace by 1 over 24 times sum of all permutations. That's 24 terms, right? But this time, not all are different, okay? So we can do some simplification. So let's see what terms are equal. How many terms will be equal? Okay, that depends on the symmetry of this, right? If it already has some symmetry, then you don't have to symmetrize. So what are the symmetries that it has? So if you exchange 1 and 3. 1, 3 exchange, let's see if it's manifest symmetry. Okay. I exchange 1 and 3. Okay. So that exchanges mu and rho. Okay. And then 1 and 3 exchange here exchanges B and D. Okay. That doesn't look so hopeful, right? Just 1 and B exchange, you start going to keep this unchanged.
Both.
Yeah. So if you exchange 1 and 3 and 2 and 4, right, then it is okay, right? So at least we can see that you can replace this by 1 over 12 times sum over 12 terms. Okay, so I'll leave it as an exercise to find these. So okay, the most brute force procedure will be to sum over all permutations and then collect terms, right? I mean, some terms will be equal, obviously, by this symmetry. You collect it and you write it as sum of terms. Okay. So the general strategy should be clear, right? You write down the most general possibility, sum over all permutations, and then you try to group them together, terms which are identical. Okay, that helps you get rid of some geometry. Okay. So this vortex then will have the following structures. It's a 4 vortex. So we have E mu K1. So this is E mu K1 entering, then C mu. K2, B rho K3, E sigma. And so you have minus I, okay, there's an extra factor of I, minus I G square by 4. Then you have some 1 over 12 times. Okay, in that process you can also see if we can discover some more symmetries and reduce the terms further. Okay, this is left as an exercise. other questions?
For the
vortex
factor,
we multiply minus sign by I just now. What vortex factor?
Just multiply by I.
Just multiply by I, yes. Now minus sign is already there.
Yes.
Right? So I multiply that by I, because it's e to the is, right? That's the way to remember. That I came because it's e to the is, and that's what we are expanding it out, right? That's the factor of I. Yes, I mean, I wrote down, let me just see. I think I had an I and then there's a minus I by 6. But if, I mean, just check this.
In front there was a
minus. Yeah, because there's overall, S had an overall minus sign, right?
Oh.
And that minus sign propagated, so it's I sign is minus sign. But of course, half of them are plus, half of them are minus, right? Inside the bracket. So if you do it in another order, you may get overall minus sign. So there is one more vortex left, right? So what, which is that one?
Ghost.
So there is a ghost A vortex, right? Because you had a cubic coupling between two ghost fields and A. So let's look at that. So the interaction term was G F A B C integral D 4 X. So this will be G F A B C. Now it's P tilde U, U tilde A, U1, C tilde B, C2, U tilde. And because this acts on the B, you get IQ1. So what kind of a vortex will this be? So three momenta entering Q1, Q3, Q2. This has index A, this has index B. This carries C and B. The ghost line has to have an arrow, right? So which way does the arrow go? Yes? From C to B, yeah, that's in the propagator, but in the on this line, is it upwards or downwards?
Downwards?
Downward. See, it emerges from B, right? That was the, it emerges from B. So which vortex, which line is B line here in the vortex? This is a B line, right? So it should emerge from here. from the vortex. See, you are now referring to the vortex, not descent. Right? So here it has to emerge from this vortex, so it should be like this. So the factor will be I times G F A B C times I K 1. This is over a light, which comes in to the IS. Now, before I end, let me just discuss one puzzle here. Well, it's not really a puzzle, but it's a little confusing. So, let's look at the Feynman case. Which is a simple gauge. Here we saw that if we have a mu of k1, a tilde mu of k2, this has this structure of minus e and e minus I delta a b 1 over k1 squared. Eta mu, and then the momentum conservation function. Now, normally, when we look for the spectrum of the theory, okay, what kind of particles it contains? We look at the poles, right? The poles of the propagator represent physical particles, right? That's the general rule in quantum field theories. So here, if you look at the pole of this propagator, you see that it's proportional to eta mu, which basically suggests that there are four physical particles for the field mu, right? Because eta mu is a 4 by 4 matrix, minus 1, 1, 1, 1, right? So that suggests that there are four particles, okay, one for each index. But of course, from our experience in QBD, we know that that's not the case, right? The physical particles for a massless gauge particle, okay, as far as at the level of the propagator, there is really no difference between this and QBD. Okay? You can just think of this as an n square minus one copies of QBD if you are dealing with n SUN gauge theories. So from QED we know that for each of these gauge fields, you should really have two physical particles, right? Not four. Another question is, how do you see that this actually contains two physical particles and not four? Okay? Because Feynman gauge propagator seems to suggest that there are four. Right? If we just naively look at this, if somebody gave you this propagator and asked you to find out the physical spectrum, you might conclude that there are four particles in the propagator. So to see how this comes about, we will first use a mathematical identity, which is a eta mu nu. You can show can be written in the following way. In the notation. that k mu are labeled as k0 and the spatial component k. K bar mu, the definition of k bar mu is that it's like k mu, but the zero component changes sign. So it's minus k0 and k. Well, let me see how I have defined it. I have defined it in slightly different way. K0 minus k. Okay, it also, of course, doesn't matter because if you look at the formula, it's under the overall change of sign of k bar, it seems very good.
Summation, one of the epsilon
will be star. No, I'm not using everything is real. I'm not using any complex epsilon. Right? You are thinking of probably circularly polarized.
Yeah, in general, people write epsilon star, then when you take linearly polarized, then those have become real.
But I'm just using linear basis. Right? So it's just like this. Okay, what else? Oh, epsilon. Okay. So epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. These are in fact from the following form, as 0, epsilon 1, and 0, epsilon 2, which means that they don't have any time component. And furthermore, you have k dot epsilon 1 equal to 0, k dot epsilon 2 equal to 0, and epsilon 1 dot epsilon 2. Okay, you can in fact think of this in a Lorentz invariant term. This looks like it breaks. It's not fully Lorentz covariant, but I can also write this as k plus k bar dot epsilon 1 equal to 0, k minus k bar dot epsilon I. And epsilon I. So okay, these are entirely equivalent statements. So the ones who demand this and this, then this in turn implies that epsilon has zero time component of epsilon is zero, and the space component satisfies. Now this is an identity. Okay? This is an identity, and one way to prove this identity is to go to a particular rotational frame in which the k vector is along the z-axis. Okay? Suppose you go to a frame in which the k vector is along the z-axis, in which case epsilon and epsilon 2 can be taken to be unit vectors along the 1 and 2 directions. Right? If k is on the z-axis, okay, that you can always choose, right? You can rotate your frame to make k along the z-axis. Okay. Then epsilon 1 and epsilon 2, okay, you take to be along the 1 and 2 axis. Okay, they will automatically satisfy these relations over here. Okay. And of course, the zero component we are setting to 0 by time. I should have written, I think this identity, there may be an order k square correction, but which you don't care about. Okay, in this case, probably there is no order k squared correction, but I am thinking of this identity as an identity when k squared is close to 0. Here, k is either k1 or k2. Okay, I'll not k is equal to k1 or k2. That's our identity. This, of course, still doesn't help in solving our problem, because this, in fact, makes it manifest that there are four different polarizations, because you have epsilon 1, epsilon 2, and you also have k and k bar, right? And all of those in general propagate. So what we are going to show now is that if we take the FF two-point function, then these contributions come out. In the two-point function of f mu, mu rho and f mu sigma, only these contribute. And that's what is physical, because a correlation function is not physical. Right? We have already said that that's not a gauge invariant object. So Huygens says that the photon has two polarizations. What one exactly means in QED or in gauge theory, when a gauge, massless gauge particle has two polarizations, is that if we calculate the correlation function of gauge invariant operators, there you will find that the poles of the propagator get contribution only from two polarizations. Is this statement clear? Okay, so let's just verify that this is true. Okay, so FF, calculate the FF correlation function. So, yes.
From here actually, that one part of the first term actually one can show that that is actually the Coulomb interaction term. And and the thing is that the when one calculate the S matrix actually from the gauge invariance, this first term actually do not contribute, only the inception and epsilon term will contribute.
Well, yes, that is true in certain cases, okay, in simple cases, but in a non-abelian gauge theory, okay, you really have to sum over all of these. So you cannot just, if you just drop this first term from everywhere, I don't think you will get the right answer. That you have to, because you also have to take into account the effect of the ghosts and so on. Right? In QED, the identities are somewhat simple. Okay, but right now we are not even talking about calculating S matrix. Okay, we just want to see in the poles. Okay, that's, if somebody has given us this action, that gauge fixed action, and told us what the gauge invariant operators are, okay, could you have calculated the spectrum? Okay, and the answer is yes, we could calculate the spectrum. Because if we had already the knowledge about what the gauge invariant operators are, even though this theory has no gauge invariance, okay, then by calculating the two correlation function of the gauge invariant operators and looking for poles in those correlation functions, we can figure out what the physical particles are. Okay? Because while these poles, okay, that this 1 over k1 square gets contribution from all the four polarizations for a correlation function, for FF correlation function, they don't contribute. Is this clear? So if we calculate F tilde, mu, yeah, mu, say F tilde mu rho, mu 1, F tilde mu sigma, and I should have said earlier also that this correlation function, okay, because you are only looking at the lowest order, you take the g goes to 0 limit. Right? You keep only the result for the g goes to 0 limit. Because after if you want to calculate order g contributions, then you have to take into account various other order g contributions. Okay? So at the order g to the 0 limit, this is just k rho. A mu 0 q1 mu 0 minus q1 rho mu times k2 mu a sigma minus k2 sigma. That's proportional to an I square. Is this clear? I just replaced del mu a rho by I k mu a rho. Right? That's why this I square comes, because there is a factor of I from here, factor of I from here. So k on mu a tilde rho minus k on rho a tilde mu, k2 mu a tilde sigma minus k2 sigma a tilde mu.
A and B indices.
Pardon? A and B indices, okay. A and B indices, let's put A and A. Now K2 of course is minus K1. Okay, let's call this K. Or minus K. I'll call K1 as K. So this is proportional to k mu. This I square cancels because one of the k2s is minus k. Okay. So that minus and I square gives you plus 1, but I am just looking at the proportionality constants. So k mu, k nu, that's the first term. A rho A sigma. Eta rho sigma. Then we have to subtract the result of mu nu exchange. Sorry, mu rho exchange. So k rho k nu theta mu sigma.
How do you get
theta
over
k square, right? Yeah. Okay. That's why the proportionality constant. There 1 over k square, of course, is there. Yes, okay. So this is clear, I just combine this with this, and then this with this will give you minus k mu k sigma eta rho nu plus k rho k sigma eta rho nu. Okay. This I square with minus sign, etc., gives you plus 1, but that's not the relevant part. So now the idea is that for each of these eta, we substitute what is here. Okay? And you have to show that this part cancels out for each of the etas. Is this clear? And the way it cancels, you see, you take the first term. Okay. Then you are anti-symmetrizing in mu rho as well as in mu sigma. Okay. So just look at the first term. Okay. First term gives you k nu, and in eta rho sigma you have here k rho k bar sigma plus k sigma k bar rho over k dot k bar. Okay, k dot k bar of course has no pole, right? This is k zero square plus k vector square. So k dot k bar has no poles. Okay. But now you see that there is a k mu k rho. The first term, let's look at this k mu k rho, right? This is symmetric in mu and rho. Okay. So once you anti-symmetrize in mu and rho, which is what you are supposed to do here, this term will vanish. K mu k rho part. Is that clear? Second term has a k nu k sigma. So once you anti-symmetrize in nu sigma, okay, which is because of this term over here, that will also vanish. So this way you can show that when you, in fact, I mean, this is just a qualitative way to see it, but if you substitute this here and expand it out, you will find that all the terms cancel pairwise. Okay, but the physical reason is simply this, that you either have k mu k rho, which is anti-symmetric in mu rho, or you have k nu k sigma, which is symmetric in nu sigma, okay, and hence anti-symmetrizing makes it vanish. So this way you can convince yourself that while in the AA correlation function, all four polarizations are contributing, if you take f mu nu f rho sigma, but in this case I have taken for f mu rho f nu sigma correlation function. Okay. You still have, of course, mu and nu run over all four indices, right? So in fact, here you have more correlation functions, six, because mu rho together can take six values. Okay, this can also take six values. Yeah, so there are 36 possible combinations you can take here. Right, as opposed to 16 possible combinations in the mu nu correlation function. Nevertheless, mu nu correlation function depends on more data than f mu nu f rho sigma correlation function. Okay, because that gets contribution from all polarizations, whereas FF correlation function gets contribution only from the epsilons.
We have gauge fixed. Right?
Pardon?
We have gauge fixed and we have used that information to calculate AA correlation.
Exactly. So the AA correlation function depends on the choice of gauge. But as I discussed earlier, then FF correlation function doesn't depend on the choice of gauge, right? So here, for example, if you change alpha, if you, instead of taking the primary propagator, suppose you have taken another propagator, right? Which will have an additional term proportional to K mu K nu over K square. Okay? But we can show that those terms all do not contribute to the FF correlation function. Okay, so the only terms that contribute to the FF correlation function are these, and their contribution is universal, independent of the choice of gauge.
So these factors,
Will not. Is that clear? So that's another way of saying that the extra terms will not contribute. So the general lesson is that to get an idea of what the physical spectrum is, you really should look at the two-point function of gauge invariant operators. Okay? That will tell you, if you look for the poles of the two-point function, that as in a normal quantum field theory. Okay? But by looking at two-point function of gauge invariant operators, you are guaranteed that whatever poles you are finding actually correspond to physical states. Okay, whereas if you use gauge non-invariant operators, you will get spurious poles. Okay. For example, the ghost two-point function, right? That also has a pole. There is a 1 over k square sitting there. Okay. So ghosts are apparently massless particles. Okay. But those are not gauge invariant, right? That's why those poles don't bother us, because you don't see them in physical correlation. Yeah, but they're necessary because you have to let them run in the loop. Okay, without those, you will not get a gauge invariant correlation function at the end. So this procedure can be applied even while calculating the corrections to the masses of various particles. Right? You look at the gauge invariant correlation function. I mean, here I should have also added that what I have done here is a little bit of cheating, because this is still not gauge invariant in a non-abelian case. Only the g goes to 0 limit, this is gauge invariant. Okay. So what I have done here is the g goes to 0 limit of an analysis, in which case you can take this to be gauge invariant quantities. Okay. Because the gauge transformation of mu had one term which is del mu epsilon, okay, under which f is invariant, but there is also just g term proportional to g. That makes it, under that transformation, this is not gauge invariant. Right, it is gauge covariant. So this is the analysis that g goes to 0 limit.
For QVD, this is true.
Pardon?
For QVD
this is true, yes. Because for QVD, there is no other term, right? For QVD, this is generally gauge invariant